pleasure that I'm introducing Dr. Leonie Tienla. She's Associate Professor at the University of Waikato. She's an Associate Professor there and also Director of the Kotahi Research Institute, an Indigenous Research Institute. And we're very honored that she's come this way from New Zealand to share with us some of her wisdom on the topic of traditional healing. And glad that you were all able to make it. So you're okay, thank you. Oh, I should say, her talk is actually sponsored through the Institute of Advanced Studies through the Research for Indigenous Community Health and Rich Center. And we will also be having a presentation on the Duluth campus if you know anyone up that way as well. Thank you.
Kia ora koutou, tuatahi mihi tēnei ki a koutou kotai mai nei tēnei ahi-ahi, mihi ki te mana whenua o tēnei o ngā rohe, tēnei whenua, mihi nui ki a pōrua, Eric, ngā pōrua hau I manaaki mai I tēnei wā, mihi ubi ki ngā hoa I wanganui a tātou, a Vince, tēnā koe, tēnei tēnā koe, tēnā pōrua, kuri noa te whare, tēnā tātou katoa. So, it's lovely to be here. I've come via San Antonio, which was like really hot. And Derek always laughs about the amount of luggage that Marty's bring when we come to Turtle Island. And it's usually because we go to like a hot place and then we go to a cold place. So we need multiple changes. So my name, I want to acknowledge the people of the land, first and foremost, the tribal nations, the original tribal nations of this land, first tribal nations that were forcibly removed and placed in this territory, and acknowledge the ancestors who are gathered in this room with us, and the ancestors, my ancestors, who have travelled to meet your ancestors. So within our cultural framework, we have a belief system that when we travel from one land to another, we never travel alone, even though physically I may be the only one from my people here, but we travel with our ancestors. And so as we gather here in this human world, what we'd call te ao kikokiko, or the skin world, our ancestors gather in the spiritual realm. And so they're having their own conversations around the well-being of their descendants in these lands, and the way in which we can support each other. So I'm really honoured to be back here in Minnesota, and back here on Dakota lands, and back here at the invitation of Rich. And I want to acknowledge the Institute of Advanced Studies for your support, and Karen particularly, for the support for having us here and gathering. My tribal territory is on the west coast of the North Island. Actually, I'll start because I'm going to kind of take you on a little bit of territory movement first to kind of locate myself. My name's Leonie Pihama and I'm the Director of Te Kotahi Research Institute, which is at the University of Waikato in Waikato or Hamilton, Aotearoa, New Zealand. And we are a multidisciplinary institute, which means we're not faculty, we're not located within the faculty. We've been under the guidance and care of Professor Linda Tuhiwai Smith as the Pro Vice Chancellor of Māori, and we now have a new Deputy Vice Chancellor, Sarah Jane Chakiwai, who's from the tribal area that we're located in. So I thought it might be, at first of all, just to talk a little bit about the terminology. So we use a lot of Māori terminology and we take it for granted in our country. So I'm aware that some of it I need to explain. And if there are words I don't explain, feel free just to kind of ask and I'll talk about it. So this project is a project I did with one of my own tribal communities, and it was called Matarako. And the word mata means the face of something, and rako means trees, and in this case, plants, medicinal plants, we're talking particularly about. And so the name of this project comes from this idea, a symbolic expression in terms of the eyes of the trees that oversee our use of traditional medicine. And, you know, in naming this project, we had a gathering of, first of all, of one of my cousins who was a traditional healer, and she's since passed, and Mahini Kura Rangabs, and she gathered together a group of traditional knowledge holders, and we had what we call a wānanga, or an all-day, it was actually a two-day gathering, in one of our traditional sites, or the marae, one of our traditional gathering sites in our region. And over the 2 days, they talked about names. They talked about words associated to healing, and they had a wānanga, or they kind of intensively debated around this particular topic. And so the name that was gifted was Matalaka. And since she passed away, we've now published the report, but we've actually published it under a different name. And that was to acknowledge that it's shifted into a different space with her passing. And the new name of the report is Tu Ka Ora, which means stand of wellness. And that was really an acknowledgement of the work she did and her intention of doing this work. So there are two different publications. One is a photographic storytelling publication called Matarako, and the other is the report, moving it into a well-being space. So the name really acknowledges the essence of the way in which our guardians are. It's hard to translate these words, but Tāne Mahuta is a deity, a guardian. Some would say a god. It's not particularly the term that I like to use, because everything that's kind of laden in that word, but of the forest. And so this acknowledges the traditional healing components that come with all the children of the forest. And the realm that Tāne Mahuta oversees and protects. So, how many of you have ever been to Aotearoa, New Zealand? Or New Zealand?
Yep.
Across. There's a few. So, you'll see here they're located. So, we've had a lot of time, we've been at ARA, the American Education Research Association. And all but one person, when they heard us, said, oh, you're from Australia. So I'll say right now that's generally considered to be close to an insult. unless you say Aboriginal Australian, we can do, you know, that's a good Indigenous connection. So we sit here in the world, and this map is a map of New Zealand. And the map of New Zealand is a map of colonialism, fundamentally, because the name New Zealand, and I'm assuming it's similar with the names here, the name New Zealand came from Abel Tasman, who travelled across and in 1769 named this country after Zealandia, right, in Holland. So we were the new one. Created some havoc with some of our people in the Wewai, until Cook came back, James Cook. And he came back and voyaged around our country, and then we have the Hawaiians to thank for dealing with him not coming back again. If you know that's from Hawaiian. And whenever we have Hawaiian scholars presenting at home, often they will remind us that actually it took the older siblings to do the deed. Well, it took the younger siblings to send them back to you. But you'd see here, like, the naming. And this is really important to traditional knowledge, is naming. Naming is really important. If we understand the relevance of naming within our communities and what names carry, then actually naming is really significant in terms of how you understand the land you're on. So our ancestors named the land in relation to their whakapapa or their ancestral lines, to people who were connected, or to events or activities that happened. So you could see a name, a Māori name, and you knew something happened either with that person there or that there was a particular activity there. Or a river would be named after the kind of river it was, you know. So we have got a river between Waikato, where I live, which is there is Hamilton and Taranaki, which is New Plymouth there, and it's called the Awakino River. Right. So Awa is river, Kino is, well, simplest term, bad. can imagine what kind of river that might be. It's probably not a river you want to jump and swim in very much. So, you know, the naming was really significant to the kind of geography we had, the way, the characteristics of ways of being, the characteristics of the land, and the connectedness to the people of those territories. And we talked a little bit about this last week at ARA, around how creative colonials namers are. And so we've got the North Island and the South Island. You know, it's like, how? If you're going to rename someone's territory, you've got to at least get a little bit more creative than the North Island or the South Island. And not only in terms of the names, but also in terms of the worldview. I want to talk a little bit about North and South, things that we take for granted, which is all part of, for us, around understanding traditional knowledge, right? So if we look at this, now the name here I've got here is Aotearoa. Now that name came from one of our women who travelled on one of our waka from Hawaiki, from an original homeland. So in our story, some of our people were originally from the land already, and others voyaged through the Pacific to Aotearoa. And so one of the women on the waka saw the land in the distance, and she called Ka'au, Ka'au, Ka'au Te Aroa, and that's how it got the name. So the name itself was named from the sea, right? It was named from the sea because of the way in which it was seen, the cloud formation that was seen. So I know Vince writes about this a lot, and others wrote about the connectedness of the ocean. So the Pacific Ocean for us is Te Moana Nui a Kiwa, the Great Sea of Kiwa, and the Pacific Ocean is a pathway that connects us. And I know that that's something that Vince talks a lot about in other Pacific, particularly voyaging, people working in the waka, the voyaging area, is that in Western thought, often people talk about the sea as being the thing that separates us. Whereas in our relationship, it's actually the thing that joins us, that connects us, it's a pathway. So, worldview comes down to how you understand your land as well. So the North Island, in Māori terms, is Te Ika a Māui, the fish of Māui. So we have a direct fish relationship with Turtle Island, because this is a turtle and we're a stingray. So we have a direct relationship that is a very traditional understanding for us in terms of how we relate through the ocean. So the North Island is Te Ika a Māui. And you see at the very top, where Kaitaia is at the very top, and Wellington at the bottom, to the very top is the tail, all right? And the very bottom is the head. So Te Hiko Te Ika, Te Upoko Te Ika. So the South Island for us is either Te Waka o Māui or the Canoe of Māui or Te Waipounama, which is the greenstone waters, which is where this indigenous greenstone, Pounama, comes from. So in our worldview, we see it quite differently because we see the waka with the head and the tail is at the bottom. And the way we turn this around like this is because in our language, we talk about going up to the head and down to the tail. It doesn't make any sense that in our imagery you'd have the tail at the top and the head at the bottom. So what does that do within traditional knowledge? Well, it problematizes all notions of geography in terms of what constitutes north and what constitutes south and who got to define that in the first place. So our children will say, even in English, Māori language immersion children will say, I'm going down to Wellington. I'm going up to Wellington, sorry, up to the head. I'm going up to Wellington. I'm going down to the north. And non-speakers of the language, you know, can't quite work that out. Because you're meant to go up north and down south. So, I mean, I just wanted to bring these kind of things to play. So I think it's really what, one, I've located myself, which is actually in that New Plymouth area, or this area of the Te Ika Māori, And that's really where this research comes from. So it's really just thinking around traditional knowledge, worldviews, and how we might think about them. So I'm a mountain person. This is where this work is located. This is Taranaki. This town here, Waitara, was the first block of land to be forcibly confiscated, and the first colonial land wars were held on this for this block of land. So it's a really significant territory for us. We have a large river, and we're a coastal people. So we're a mountain people, a coastal people, and a river people, and that's really important when we think about traditional healing in this territory, because every territory has a different geographical component, different plants, different ways of being. So what we did with this particular project was that we were looking to reclaim stories from our region around traditional healing. And so we talked to 60 elders. Right. So there are about three in their 50s, between 55 and 59. The rest were over 60. And it wasn't about, you know, can you tell us about the pharmaceutical or the chemical potential of these plants. It wasn't about necessarily about what they could do and how they could do it. It was about how did elders experience traditional healing growing up. Because we were interested in what kind of knowledge our people still held in the community around traditional healing. And the importance of that was that in the time, you know, in this last 20 years, we've been really working hard to bring some of that daily knowledge back into our lives. Because Māori health statistics are so bad, are seen so negatively, and the way in which a health system operates, we've become, as most people in our country have become, incredibly reliant on the professional to heal us. And ideas of self-healing, whether it be physical self-healing or through emotional issues, whatever, the idea of self-healing has become more and more removed from our lives. So this was really around what kind of knowledge did whānau or extended families have in their elder generation available to them. And the thing around doing it was that we really worked to do an intergenerational transfer during the work. And so families were trained, whānau, members of whānau, extended families were trained and worked with to interview their own elders. And what that did was it helped to serve as a transfer of knowledge between generations. So it's a transformative practice in the research method itself. Because there's this real obsession in qualitative research to have me come and interview you, and you share all this amazing information with me, and then I determine what gets written down and what gets shared, and no one else hears it. And so then whānau or families get to read what I think is important. But in this context, they actually got to have their own conversations at the same time. So people were hearing things that they had never heard before, because often we don't ask those questions of our own elders, or we don't sit long enough with our own elders to actually have the conversation. So it was kind of multi, it's what we call a kaupapa Māori approach methodology. It's a very indigenous approach to doing the work. So you get kind of a multiple sharing across the process, so it becomes kind of transformative in method itself. So some of the first things that came up were the historical consideration, so colonisation as a historical consideration. What is the impact of colonisation on our lands? I just want to jump to the next slide and I'll come back. So you can see here in 1860 in the blue, wish I had a pointer bit. So that was Māori land, still held in Māori collective, I don't want to use ownership, but collectively Māori still held the land in blue in 1860 on Te Ika Māui. And you can see in the very, on the edge there, there's a white part on the bit that sticks out. So that land is the land that I was talking about where I'm from, and that was the first lot of land that had been initially confiscated. Right? So it was confiscated, returned, confiscated again. So you can see the blocks of land. So pretty much we held most of our lands initially in the early 1860s. And this is the land in 2000. And actually this is even less now. And there are some parts where you can't see any blue dots because the land holdings are so small. So this is colonization. So this, if you're living in a healing process that's around your land, your sea, your plants, there's a major shift in your ability to do that with the confiscation of land. And this is from one of the South Island groups, Ngaitahu. So 1844, 1864, it was nearly all gone. The entire Te Waipounamu was nearly all gone. And that, so that's in a period of 20 years. 20 years. So we can't talk about any of this work if we don't actually acknowledge the forcible removal of our land, the confiscation of our land, and the impact of that in terms of our ability to live on our lands, to live with our foods, to live with our medicines, to live with our relationships and connectedness. And so our people call this Muruaupatu. That's the Māori term for confiscation. They call it confiscation, they translate it. But it actually means to be beaten over 100 times. That's how our ancestors understood confiscation, was to be beaten. So it wasn't just, you know, people talk about a loss of land in terms of Indigenous people, talk about a loss of language, a loss of culture. That implies something accidental. There was nothing accidental. I lose my keys in the morning, nearly every morning. I don't lose my language. I don't lose my culture, and I certainly don't lose my land. It's not lost. It's been forcibly removed. And the significance, as I said, of that is that it disconnects us and becomes this event and a series of historical trauma events that lead to that confiscation, create a whole series of historical trauma impacts that come from that. And so we've been really fortunate at home to be, you know, to have work like Derek and Michelle are doing here, Karina, Tessa, Bonnie Duran, Eduardo Duran, Maria Yellowhorse Braveheart, those Indigenous scholars that are taking the framework of historical trauma and looking at it not only in terms of that historical impact but also the intergenerational impact on our people. The Tohunga Suppression Act, I'm going to come back to that in a minute. The denial of language and culture. Denial of language and culture means a denial of knowledge. It's like a denial of names. So when you remove an Indigenous language, you remove an access to layers of knowledge that are very difficult to get back. It doesn't mean we're not able to get them back. But what it does is it just removes a whole range of connectedness to the knowledge base that we have. So we went upstairs to the exhibition, and so I saw, you know, Kawakawa was the first one in the exhibition upstairs, and we have Kawakawa, and it's the same family, but with different properties and different ways of being. So Kawakawa for us is something that is very much a healing medicine. It does a whole range of internal healings, external healings, and it's also the plant that we use for grieving. So we're reintroducing more of our traditional burial processes now within our region as a direct result of this kind of regeneration of traditional knowledge, where our people are wrapped entirely in kawakawa before they're wrapped in traditional wraps. So we don't need to be using embalming and that kind of thing. I mean, that kind of poison, that poisons the land again. Because we have a whole range of understandings just in that plant alone that enable us to do ancient protocols and ways of being in a contemporary way. So the Totemus Appreciate Guide, just kind of introduced before, was an act that outlawed native healers or tohunga. They were traditional experts. So you can have tohunga in healing, tohunga in carving, tohunga in waka of canoes, in terms of traditional knowledge, tohunga in a whole range of traditional experts. And it forced many underground. So it forced that knowledge into hiding. And it really worked to discount traditional knowledge and traditional healing. And all of those things that came. And the tuberculosis, but you know, there was the flu epidemic and tuberculosis, a whole range of illnesses that were brought to our land that had never been there prior, became the kind of first line of advocating for the removal of this knowledge from our communities. So, and often those specialists were constructed as having some kind of mental illness or not quite being right, or if we talked about Māori understandings of certain ways of being in terms of mental health, they were dismissed. And so the Tohunga Suppression Act worked to, I was saying to Michelle earlier, they didn't necessarily charge a lot of people under this act, although they charged enough to create a fear within the community, right? So it's like surveillance. You don't even have to have a working camera. You just have to appear to have a working camera. And that's a kind of, you know, the Foucauldian notions, you know, around surveillance, which we know. And so, but the first, what was really significant for our work is that the first person to be charged was a Māori woman from our territory. And she had been working for many years with her community, and she was charged, as it says here, by practicing on their superstitions or credulity, and she was misled, and she had misled them by professing to profess supernatural powers in the treatment or cure of diseases. And so the one thing that, you know, was really clear in the ruling around her engagement with the court was that she would not admit to that. She would not renounce it. But as a consequence, she did have to agree to not be so active in that. So she found other avenues of working with local white Pākehā doctors of the area of the time. So 1907 was the act, and 1910 was the first court case in terms. And this is not new. I mean, this will be familiar, I'm assuming, to people here. So that's like the context. That's the context of thinking about, in very brief terms, of thinking about traditional healing within our territory. Invasion in terms of colonisation. We had a range of communities that were actively invaded by the militia. Over that period, we had both our territory in terms of Waitara and that land, and we had another spiritual tribal area, Parihaka, which is about 45 minutes to the south and to the coast, that was actively invaded by the militia in 1881, November 5, 1881. And the entire community was taken aside, and all able-bodied men were shackled on boats and taken to the very bottom of Te Waipounamu, so the very bottom, as far away from home as you could get. And they were imprisoned in caves there, and many didn't return. That entire community was then occupied by the militia, and so it was an entire community of children, women, and elders. So the oppression and the rape and the abuse in that community went on for a very long period of time. So this is the context when we're talking about regenerating traditional knowledge, right? We're regenerating a knowledge against all odds, you know, against a whole range of mechanisms where the state has condoned violence and condoned a whole range of activities against our people based on a need for and a desire for control of the land, control of the resources, control of the entire country, in fact, as a colonial, a new colonial land, which is the New Zealand bit, for settlers. And we don't use that term. I know they use that term, settlers, a lot, like settler colonial society here. We don't really use that term a lot. So we use the term Pākehā, which is those descendants of the first, and those that have come since, descendants of those first colonial invaders, really, that came to our land. So I just want to talk a little bit now, so that's the context. So then I said before around, you know, utilising the whānau or the extended family context for actually doing the work. And, you know, I know that within a Western science methodology, you know, people will be going, that's not very objective. Well, you know, because we fundamentally believe that actually no science and no research is objective. It's all entirely subjective. It may be hidden in ideas of objectivity and neutrality. But, you know, in our experience of research, and if you've seen Linda Smith's book, Decolonizing Methodologies, definitely the experience through the Pacific Nations and Indigenous, for Indigenous nations, you know, science in our lands began as a justification of a racial hierarchy that could then provide a rationale for the removal of our land. It was never about anything other than that. So craniometry or craniology as a science, which disproved itself time and time again and then reproved itself, was entirely subjective. And if we look back in terms of that Western science frame, you know, it's really evident. Now, we can have all of these hypotheses about Indigenous people that will constantly change to re-rationalise colonialism. So for our people, that came through notions of millet, you know, measuring millet and skulls. That was all part of that overall racial hierarchy theories. You know, until you find a Māori that's got the biggest skull, then what do? You know? Because surely you can't be more intelligent. Yes, all of that, you know, which you're all familiar with and you all know, through to our existing education system and our knowledge system that is really based within curriculum and assessment and measuring of intelligence that looks nothing like the kind of Indigenous intelligence that we bring to the table. And actually we have, you know, the proof we have of that is that our Māori immersion students that are learning through Māori language, that are learning through Māori knowledge, that are learning with Māori culture, actually even in the national standards go beyond any other Māori student in the mainstream system. Which means that we're taking our students through an Indigenous intelligence process that is not, doesn't look like what's happening to our children in a mainstream conventional school. So there's a whole lot of things that happen, you know, that deny this knowledge. And for our people within our region, I'm only speaking for our people within the Taranaki region, although it resonates across many Indigenous nations. Trying to bring back this knowledge really had to start at a whānau level, at an extended family level, sharing through your own families. And so we had, you know, people talked about their stories. So the overarching question really, or aim really was for people to share, elders to share their experience of traditional healing growing up. How did they experience traditional healing? And what kind of things did they remember? And once people started having those conversations, it was amazing the memories that came back. The people, the memories of their childhood that came back. And so they came back in terms of talking about a whole range of ways of healing. So kai, which is food in this context. Okay. So it's food both in physical sustenance, but it's food also and spiritual and intellectual. So we have a saying that says, te kai o te rangatira he kōrero, the food of, I don't want to say chiefs, but of collective leaders is dialogue. So kai has a whole range of meanings. Everyone talked about this. All of the 60 people talked about this in some way. And in this context, they talked about food. So that how traditional foods were themselves medicines, right? That's why the exhibition on the fourth floor is so great, right? Because it's both medicine, but they're also, you know, for us, that would be kind of our food sources too. And so they talked about different types of food that they remember growing up. And some of these were imported. So pumpkin and corn, they were imported foods. But they were something that were easy to grow and people could get their hands on and grow it. And corn itself here has a strong relationship to well-being anyway, and so our people quickly took that up. But piharo is a form of lamprey eel, taio is a form of Māori potato or traditional potato, kumara is a sweet potato, and kamokamo is like a, it's kind of like a, not a melon, but
squash.
A what?
Like a squash.
Squash, yeah, it's squash. And so it was both, and people talked about both the food itself, but actually a lot of the well-being was actually in the planting and the curing of the food, so the physical activity in doing the food. So it's always multi-layered. And here, we knew how to preserve our kai. So here they say, we put down sacks of kāma wai every year. Kānga wai, or people call it kānga piro, is rotten corn, so fermented corn. And that would see us through to the next season. So we knew how to preserve food, but also it was a collective activity of sharing. So it was the food itself, it was the planting and gardening and physical activity of food, and it was the collective sharing and preserving of food for a collective well-being. And in many ways, it doesn't seem like a big thing, but you know, in a neoliberal economic context where many people cannot afford food, you know, we gotta move back to collective food sharing. Collective gardening, collective food sharing. I remember even as a child, we used to have fish trucks that would come by, and to many of the whānau that were on single incomes, those people would drop fish off. You'd drop off fish, you would share food. But when we think about, you know, I've always seen this work not only about traditional healing, but also as poverty intervention. Moving away from the individualistic lifestyle that we have, which is about our own individual self and family, nuclear family self-preservation, to more collective obligation and collective sharing. So, and anyone can do that. For me, that's an indigenous lifestyle that we lead, but actually anyone can do that. Anyone can plant multiple fruit trees and gardens and share them with those communities that don't have. So, and this is a kind of another one around the food. So kai or food wasn't just about preventing illness or being sick. In fact, most traditional medicines are actually around the bigger picture of collective well-being, individuals being well within collectives, but also how to grow the food and nourish the body through being in the soil. And that, you know, when I talked about the muru daupatu, or the confiscation of your lands, how do you be in your soil if your lands have been forcibly removed? How do you be in the soil if you're being forcibly, and with your traditional food, if your traditional food is from another region and you're being forcibly relocated to a region where you can't grow that traditional food? How do you be in the land as communities that are urban contexted and live in concrete? How do we connect into the land? And these were from people over 60, right? These were from elders sharing these. So the other thing that came up all the time was karakia. And karakia is like those blessings that we give for everything we have. So I don't use the word prayers, because in our country, prayers is loaded by a colonial, church-based, religious God as male, God as white, baggage. It's loaded with all of that. And karakia, some of our people would refer, to those kind of prayers as karakia, but for me, karakia is about a traditional way of giving blessings. It's about traditional ceremonies, about traditional protocols, for being thankful for what we have. And one of our conferences last year, Joe Williams, who's actually Māori Land Court judge, he gave a presentation and he talked about this. He talked about karakia. And he gave an example of one. And he talked about the difference between doing indigenous frameworks or Māori frameworks of karakia and prayer. And the difference was, in our traditional karakia, we are not asking for a god to give us something. We are not asking for any help. It's not based on asking for something. It's based on affirming and acknowledging what we have. It's based on acknowledging the land. It's based on acknowledging the beauty of a sunrise. It's based on those things. It's based on giving thanks for what we have, rather than save me from my sins. The kind of forgiveness notion which you then go and repeat tomorrow and then ask for forgiveness again the day after. So karakia in this work was, again, so the things that I'm talking about are the ones that came up all of the time. There's our helper. Through the project. So our people would go and they would give thanks and they would karakia for well-being. Why? This is probably one of the biggest issues that we have next to the land and language issues, and that's water. The access to water for our well-being. And this, as we know, with contexts such as Standing Rock, we have many of those contexts at home with the potential pollution of rivers and of water. Most of the rivers in our country, which have been, come from poor water sources, most of them are not up to a standard. They're not drinkable for sure, and many of them are not swimmable. So, water and the well-being of water is a global issue. If we don't protect our water and support water protectors, our children will not have water. If our children do not have water, and our grandchildren, we will not exist. So, these elders have always talked about water, the significance of water, because we are nearly all water ourselves. And the way that we introduce ourselves is, first of all, we'll say, Nō hiakoe, so where are you from? But when we introduce who we are, if someone asks you, ko waikoe, they're asking you, whose waters do you come from? So, any woman that's had their waters break at birth, but we know exactly what that term means. That is, who are your people? Who are you from? Whose waters do you come from? So water traditionally has always been seen not only as a healer, but actually as a fundamental sustainer of who we are. We're not talking about what plants do what. We're talking about conceptually the overarching knowledges that we need even to get to that point in terms of traditional knowledge. But what that why word does, when you add it to trees, is it talks about the medicines that come from plants. So the water of the plants, the way in which those medicines come. And so a lot of people talked about the medicines. And here, kawakawa is the same family as the Kawakama up in the gallery. And it was really great for me to see that the first time around. Because when we travel through the Pacific as Māori, we know the relationship to Kawa and to Awa in a way that's a spiritual relationship, the way that we understand our relationship to Kawakama. So Koromiko is a plant that is really to do with stomach and issues, periods, period pains. You would eat some of this, and seriously, off, gone. Amazing plants. And then things like dysentery would actually help you to bind up again. These are beautiful things. Hadakiki or flax root, the kōmiko again. So these are two different people talking about different plants. Kawakawa is, as I said, kawakawa you can drink internally. It's an asthma preventative, so you can drink it as an asthma preventative. You can drink it as a tea, and it's just so easy, right? You just go and pick some leaves off the plant, give thanks to the plant, pick some leaves, make a cup of tea and drink it. It's as simple as that. But it's also a kind of natural antiseptic, so you put the underside onto a poultice, and it will draw out infection amazingly. It'll draw it out within an hour or two. And then you turn to the other side of the leaf and it helps to heal. So it's like a miracle plant. You can also use it after you've had your cup of tea, if you have children with eczema, you can just rub it on them two or three times a day. It's a preventative. It's not necessarily the healer for eczema, but it helps to prevent eczema. So, doing this work has really led in our territory to more people going back to the making of traditional medicines. So to making ointments with kawakawa, medicines with koromiko, it really has supported the growth of traditional healing in this sense within our people. So kawakawa tea in the morning, you might have a kawakawa poultice, put it in a cloth, warm it up. So these are examples of what people did growing up and the generation before our generation. Having a bath, this is like the best plant for your hair. Yes, lye and kawakawa. Mm. And this is one that was really actually much more common than we thought it would be, and that's urine, mimi, your own mimi. And how you use that for not major cuts, for small cuts, for stings. So my kids, my older children, so I've got twins, they're 26, my next door is 23, a 13, soon to be 14-year-old, and then twins that are 9. So the big children, can't watch Friends. This might seem strange to you, but the program Friends, and there's one show, I don't know if any of your friends watch it in the past, there's one show where they go to the beach and they get stung by a jellyfish, and it's this kind of hilarious engagement around who did the mimi, right? Because someone had been told, you mimi on it. And it was Joey, of course, so it's kind of crazy. With Mom. And my children were just in fits of laughter because they had heard that from the stories from their grandfather. That when he was a child, his grandmother would say to him on a sting, mimi on it. I think ideally you're meant to use your own rather than someone else's, right? It's like people who drink it, right? You're not actually meant to drink someone else's. You're actually meant to use your own. Because it's releasing goodness, actually, on the whole, if you will. So they would watch that particular one over and over again, and they would laugh. They would be rolling on the ground because they couldn't remember. But the other one was cobwebs. And when we hear stories of Spider here and Spider Woman here, after So my father talked both about, this is not his way, my elder sister interviewed my father. And that's as objective as we got, like I didn't interview him. So she interviewed my father, and when I read his stories, I remember as a child the things that he would do, which I had totally forgotten, you know, in my life. He talked about mummy, but he also talked about cobwebs. So when we see the relationship to spiders here for many native tribes, you know, it just reminds us that actually that was a traditional healing process that our people used. So you would wrap a cut with a cobweb and it would heal it. And so this is another example. There are a number of examples where people talked about both of these things. A whole range of things that we used to do when we were children that we just thought was a little bit nuts, you know, because we were very well schooled around not believing pretty much anything around traditional knowledge. We were raised with no language in our home. My father was fluent until he was 10, and he was beaten so badly at school he just stopped, just like that, bam, stopped speaking. Then he made a decision that we would never experience that. So he would not speak to us. And my entire life, our entire life growing up, we pretty much never heard a word of Māori coming out. But he did lots of Māori things, you know. He would go and get cobwebs. He would go and do all kinds of things. He would look after the tribal cemetery. He would do kinds of things like that. We'd have big collective gatherings. So we lived cultural ways with no language. And so the whole thing about the removal of language, as I said, that kind of loss of language, many of our generations, because I hear a lot of people at home say, well, you know, they should have just taught them. Well, actually, it's not that easy. You imagine being a child beaten for something. You stop doing it. You get it enough, you stop doing it. And the last thing you want for your children is for them to experience the negative things. Most generations say, I want something better for my children. And that's, you know, something for the young people in this room to remember too, is that often as parents or as grandparents, we want something better for our children. So we're not going to repeat things that will bring harm to them. And this is another example where, a grandmother actually looked after cobwebs. But we were busy cleaning cobwebs out of everything. We're actually all removing, you know, a bandage from our house, and then we go down the road and we pay $10 to buy a box of bandages. Mm-hmm. And actually, we've got a whole lot of bandages in our homes already and around our homes already. So, in terms of this work, it is about traditional healing, and it is about experiences of that generation. But it's actually much more than that. It's around how do we regenerate knowledge and language and culture and connectedness within our communities to run as ways of intervening in some of the issues that currently face Indigenous people. So it's not just about health. It's not just about mental health. In fact, mental health was never a frame. We had a range of ways that we talked about people's state of being, but they were accommodated within a collective way of being. But so it's not only about well-being, it's not only about healing, but it's also about supporting communities that are seeking language regeneration, supporting communities that are seeking reconnectedness to their land, supporting communities that are seeking to be able to have our protocols, our ceremonies within a range of spaces that they are not normally held. Supporting people to live in a context now, and as I said, which is a very neoliberal economic context, which is about wealth, the value of wealth, rather than the value of human beings and the value of people, and a return. So what this work has done is also really mobilised us to think around collective well-being. And as I said before, it is about an individual being well. But it's about an individual being well as a part of collective. Because you can have individuals that are well and have entire people that are not. Whereas if you have an entire collective that is well, every individual inside that collective is well. You know what I mean? So it's about shifting our mindset out of this kind of individual one-to-one notion and thinking more around collective and around history. Because when we're working with other people, it's not enough just to say, oh, I'm working with this individual in front of me. Because within Indigenous knowledge frameworks and well-being, everything that has happened to our ancestors is a part of who we are. So within our terms, we would say, we have a term for ancestor, which is tūpuna. Tū is to stand, puna is like a fountain, right? For a fountain woman. We have a term for a grandchild, which is mokopuna. Mokopuna, moko is this, okay, imagery, the images that we carve on our skin, and puna again is like a fountain. So mokopuna, a grandchild, is the embodiment of their grandparent, of their ancestor. Mokopuna is the walking embodiment of an ancestor. So, where epigenetics now might tell us we carry stress intergenerationally, that's exactly what we're saying. We're saying that this generation are carrying both the incredible knowledge and being of our ancestors, but if the trauma of our ancestors has not been resolved or healed, we also carry that until such time as it is healed. And one of our aims is to try to work out ways for that healing to occur collectively so that we don't pass it on to the next generation to have to do the work, the healing. So there are multiple kind of collective ways of being that we're talking about when we talk about traditional healing. And traditional knowledge is not only held within an individual. Traditional knowledge is held within a collective. So when I talked about tohunga or particular experts, they were experts in particular things, but it's actually when they all came together with their expertise that the entire collective knowledge of traditional knowledge could be seen. That we all contribute to that knowledge base. And in many ways, that's what saved a lot of our knowledge, because it was never housed in one person. It was never carried by one person. Multiple people within our collectives had roles to bring that knowledge forward to pass on. So that's really what I wanted to share today. It's a little bit all over the place, but I wasn't quite sure on how to focus it particularly into this. And because we're doing a lot of other work around historical trauma and healing of sexual violence and healing of things like domestic violence and those kinds of being, but what we do know from this and a range of other work is that actually if we don't do this collectively, if we don't look at collective healing, we will never really heal individuals. And if we don't see that there are a range of ways of doing that for Indigenous people, and that traditional knowledge healing needs to be really a part of that framework, then we're going to just keep reproducing the same things that we're doing now. So no they that tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou. Thank you.
I'd like to open it up. My name is Dr. Jeff Jennings. I'm an outreach director of Rich Research and Indigenous Community Health. And I'd like to open up for any questions for Dr. Fiona. Comments, questions?
My name is Robert Chuck. I'm a college pharmacy also, and I forgive me for not knowing a great deal about concepts and perceptions of accustomed to this culture, but I'm kind of curious about something you said at the end about epigenetics, and
yeah,
that being perhaps a scientific explanation of the perceptions of transmission of senses or feelings or inheritance of direct inheritance of things beyond genetic things. I'm also curious about perceptions of the culture of the classical interpretation of genetics being a determinant of, in some ways, how predisposition to disease, perhaps how people respond to traditional and non-traditional medicines and so on like that. And just in that culture, what is their perceptions of genetics, per se, or epigenetics?
Yep. So I guess in terms of epigenetics, when now people see what comes out through that frame, we go, oh, yeah, we knew that. you know, that's the kind of response. We were told that, you know, we've known that for 1,000 years. So, and science is slowly starting to catch up, or at least one branch is trying to catch up. So that's kind of, it's not necessarily the same thing, but, you know, at least there's something we can touch base on the same way, actually. When you talk about that, we've already been talking about this for a very long time. In terms of genetics, and, you know, there's a lot of discussion around genetics in our country at the moment, because we had someone who went and did a media person who went and did a genetics test, and then I think it was through ancestor.com, and, you know, one of those sites, and they came back and said there's a full-blooded Māori here, because genetics tell us that she's 98%, and the other 2% is just noise. So yeah, if you get 98%, you actually got 100%, right? That's science. But actually, our ancestral relationships are not determined by genetics. So our ancestral relationships are determined by what we call whakapapa, which is a cultural template of genealogical ancestral relationships, not even really genealogical. I mean, it's quite, because genealogy is very much a kind of nuclear family two by two. You know, two people have two children, have two children. You know, it's that very linear construct. Whereas within, when we use the word whakapapa as an ancestral template, it means to layer, right? Papa is foundation, whakapapa is to make foundations. So our genealogical framework looks like this, right? Multiple layers. It goes as high, it goes as wide, as it is, which is, you know, quite different to the kind of ethnographic anthropological models that they kind of draw us in some really nice, tidy, little, linear, dualistic way. So that's the kind of conceptual way. People will often use some of our language to translate as DNA, but it's actually not DNA. We don't really have it. We don't have a term for DNA as a chemical form of what DNA is. We talk about our fundamental essence of being who we are, which is Ida. Ida is the fundamental essence that makes up all of the parts of who we are. And within our traditional knowledge, inside of every one of them, every Ida, we would say is a wāna. It's a gathering of knowledges. So what that means is that they're all related. So we really have no reason to trust an idea of DNA or genetic manipulation or genetic modification, because it disrupts the cultural relationships that happen with inside every part of the essence of who we are. And we know that genetics on the whole has been used for Indigenous people around things like quantum and other things, more to disappear us. Because, you know, we had, up to the late 60s, you were only a Māori if you were a quarter caste. So you could be a half caste or a quarter caste, but once you were beyond that, you were not considered a Māori person anymore, except for when you're arrested. Then when you're arrested, all of a sudden you're a Māori person. So right into the 60s, that kind of quantum percentile notion was a part of how we were defined. They actually, we're, you know, because we're a small country, there are some things that we can really push against quite hard, and that was one. In terms of our relationships with each other. So that, you know, it's a self-identification through ancestral line. And there is an expectation within your communities that you can speak to your ancestors, and you have the stories of your ancestors, and you can speak to the connectedness to your land. And that those of our people, many of our people who were forcibly adopted out of our communities through the 50s and 60s, through closed adoptions, you know, there's been an active movement to reconnect those people back into community. So the notion of genetics really operates against, in my view, a notion of being Indigenous Well, what we'd say, Tonga Te Whenua, people of the land, it really mitigates against the ways that we determine our relationships to each other. And it's very dangerous because, you know, at some point they're going to be able to say, none of you have got the necessary quantum and therefore you no longer exist in our eyes. It doesn't mean that we have to buy into that, although some do. But there's been this big debate at home around, you know, this test that was done. And everyone's going, oh, we thought there were no full-blooded Māoris left. No. So we're talking about someone who is, you know, a grandparent from Europe, right? As a Pākehā or a white settler, white New Zealander in her genealogy, so which we know. But we don't determine our relationship only by that. We determine our relationship as Māori by our Māori ancestral line. Doesn't mean we deny the other lines, but that's our relationship to each other. So it's been a huge uproar, and actually Kim Torby did a really great critique on Twitter. I was watching her come through on Twitter around it, you know, and because we know her, people like Deb Harry from Indigenous People's Council on Biocolonialism, strong critique of that work, Woman from Home, Other Than Me, you know, the way in which DNA and genetics are used to define by others who we are. And my reply to it was partly, well, you know, it's another example of our own TV channel, Māori Television, talking about something they know nothing about. Or the complexities, because it was all kind of rah-rah-rah, there's a full-blooded Māori. Yeah. And that's the thing about science, right? 98% becomes 100%. Go figure. That doesn't happen in examinations. If you get 98%, you're not 100%. But aside from that, really problematic for us. That's a long answer, but it's a fun question.
Yeah. I like the way you diagram that because it's really consistent with the way that Indigenous people here in North America think about our ancestral knowledge as more of a stream.
Yeah.
And you know the idea of like the things that we inherit, whether that's medicine or whether that's certain ways of sort of operating in the world through our ancestors, is more of a sort of a non-physical inheritance and not,
yeah.
You know, it's more like a randa, the more knowledge of spirit and power that you inherit rather than like something that's in your physical makeup,
which
Western people are really obsessed with.
Yeah.
But one thing that really stood out for me in your talk was when you were talking about how they purposefully sort of locked up, you know, they created a law to lock up the healers and the traditional medicine people, call them crazy and step them. Well, we had something very similar happen here in America. Not a lot of people know about the Hiawatha Insane Asylum and outside of Canton, which is outside of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, but that was an institution that was created in 1903 that was specifically designed to institutionalize American Indian people. A lot of the people that were institutionalized that were actually spiritual leaders or healers are people who were resistors who wouldn't sort of kind of fall into line with the Indian agents or the people who sort of kind of were like troublemakers and rabble rousers. But what's interesting for me is that you know, one of the first things that happened to us as Native people through the colonization process was that we were removed from our land, so our first relationship with our Earth Mother was severed. Then our ceremonies were outlawed, right? So we were getting killed or murdered for your ceremonies, or worse, imprisoned, like in places like Canton. And those are the two primary sources that we would have gone to historically for healing, right? So all of our, like you're describing, like all of the ways in which you would heal yourself from any physical or spiritual or emotional ailment is embedded in the land and your relationship to the land and all of the things that the land gives you. And now that we're in 2016, 2017, 21st century, we have to sort of struggle as Native people and Indigenous people for the right to be able to access those things. Right? And then myself as the CEO of a Native health clinic, like I have to justify in 20 million different ways why traditional practices should be reimbursable or should be honored just like Western science. So it's just, to me, it's like that's just more of the sort of like the ongoing impact of colonization on tribal health. We have the worst health disparities around the world, you know, us, other indigenous people like you, and it's like, and it's embedded in the actual way in which we are forced to continue to practice. So to do the things that you're talking about make a lot of sense.
So I wanted to thank you again. I've been learning from you guys in Aotearoa for so many years, and I just want to share that it never ceases to amaze me how productive you guys have this effort to really look to tradition for learning about how to looking to tradition for the way to reinvest in it. So this is just learning from tradition like that. It's actually there's a lot of really powerful intellectual material making of what you've got informed by it to produce systems for the 21st century. You know, that's what a lot of us are trying to struggle with in Native studies, in the communities and all that, right? We all have a sense of that traditions and genealogies have something, but we don't always know how to work it. And I'm just really thankful about how studied I think you guys have been about being informed by that to produce something that will continue to not even be colonized, it's really to flourish. Yeah. So thank you.
Any other questions or comments?
Thank you for your talk. I was really interested in this idea of kind of the interviewing of elders and talking, and I was hoping you could like maybe go in a bit more detail about kind of how that process works, how it's facilitated.
So as I said at the beginning, all of the elders were interviewed by members of their whānau or their extended family. So, and that was very deliberate because we wanted the project not to be about what happened at the end. So the kind of methodology that Linda talks about, decolonizing methodologies, and the kaupapa Māori or the Māori philosophy approach to methodologies, it's really that our work should be transformative in process as much, in fact, the process becomes more important necessarily than the outcome. So, it was about enabling a process whereby people transferred knowledge intergenerationally as well as sharing knowledge with a wider community. And so that was facilitated by the people who were a part of healing, knowing, you know, having links into communities and really inviting elders to be a part of it, if they wanted to be a part of it, and then inviting their daughters, sons, cousins, or whoever it was, to grandchildren, to be a part of the method. Yeah. And so it's very much about that. It's very much about, as I said, you know, unless a person wants to be interviewed individually because we're doing something, you know, that that they need confidentiality around. So it might be family violence, it might be sexual violence, it might be something like that, or talking against the state where people don't want to be named. If people want that level of confidentiality, then, you know, they will do the one-to-one interviews. If they're about sharing the knowledge they have as elders, then we will open it. So we've got a whole range of methods that we use under this framework that's about collective knowledge sharing. But in this one, it was what was more important was the knowledge between generations. Yeah, so it was elders to their own family. And as I said, what it did is it triggered people to think about what had happened with their elders. Yeah. I mean, we only included pretty much in this the stories around the healing. But there are a lot of other stories shared that we haven't included here because those are only for the family, so only for their relations to have. So there are a whole range of methods that we're employing. And when we think about Indigenous methodologies and decolonising methodologies and those processes, I think where we're really at the moment is actually moving to the methods component. How do we actually do this? How do we take these methodological approaches and actually do it on the ground with our people? And that means thinking beyond the idea of a focus group or an individual interview as the way that you share knowledge. Because if we're about knowledge, you know, transformation, then we've got to do things quite differently. And one of them, so where I'm from, when I talked about Pihiaka, one of the villages that was invaded, the philosophy in that village was that no one would talk to the colonial government on their own. Now that happens all the time now in treaty settlements. Little groups of people go and lock themselves in closed rooms and they do all the settlement with the government or whoever, or the state, around what's happening with our land or, you know. And it's very confidential and it's very driven by that kind of Western notion of closed door. You know, whereas where we're from, that never happened. So our elders in that community, those that gave guidance and spiritual guidance and leadership of that community would never speak to the colonial government except for in front of the people. So what that raised for us is, well, what does that mean as researchers? What does that mean for us as a method of being, a collective knowledge sharing? So that has enabled us to create a range of, you know, ways of being and being community researchers and academic researchers who are part of communities. So I get brought into, I've both done a lot of research with my own tribal groups and I've also been in the university, and sometimes it's been both simultaneously because we are both at the same time. And often, so for this one, it was actually my cousin rang me up who led this, who was the healer of the time, and she said, "You will da da da." And I went, "Okay." There are some cousins you just don't say no to. And actually, most of the research that I've been involved in has been around that kind of function. Not just from my own tribal people, but from a whole range of mine. When I've been in the university, because I haven't only been. I last so long in the university, and then I go back and, you know, be within community-grounded work. So that process was really about that. It's about bringing indigenous methods to the methodologies. Because what I see often happens is that we will talk about an indigenous methodology and we rush off and do something very Western. Mm-hmm. And there's a total disconnect. And I just think, disciplinary, we would never enable that to happen. That you have people saying, "I'm doing a decolonizing methodology," and then they go do something that looks like something very colonial. You know? And so it's connecting those. And so that's what happened with the family, with those processes. It was really amazing. The one thing that I wish that we had done, actually, was to have interviewed the next generation as well, to see what kind of knowledge the next generation held, which is like more of my generation, compared to the knowledge that the elders held. Because my sense is, a lot of that knowledge was not passed down because we became more urbanised in the next generation. A whole lot of other things happened in that generation. So people were learning in the tūpiki of their own elders. There was one other thing that I didn't talk about which I really should have, and that's probably, apart from all of the detail of the healing, I think the most significant outcome of this was that our people were self-healing before they went to anyone else. We did not get up and go, I've got a cold, I need to go to the doctor. And not even to our own tohunga, our own specialist. Extended whānau had enough healing knowledge within our own extended family structure to heal your daily illnesses. You went to the tohunga or the expert for other things. So healing bone breakages. There'd be someone who did that specialty. Different specialties. But if you had, you know, some kind of breathing or asthma or whatever, which was not prevalent so much prior to colonialism, but, you know, is more prevalent with the introduction of new plants that bring, you know, allergies and asthma. But even in that generation, you didn't go running to find a doctor to give you a Ventolin. You know, you went out the back and you picked some plants and you went and you bought it and you drank a cup of tea. So self-healing, I think, has been removed from not only from Indigenous nations, but from pretty much everyone, that we've become so reliant on the professional thing, the person who's going to heal us. So another project we're doing around approaches to trauma-informed care, Indigenous approaches, one of the healers in that is saying, you know, we're not going to focus this on a counsellor or a social worker or a therapist being the healer that we have to go to. We want to know what were the self-healing principles and concepts of our people. So, you know, it's kind of all in that. That's a lot, I mean, I get a bit long-winded in my responses, but I really did want to say that was probably a key outcome, was actually self-healing.
I think we're going to wrap it up. I think we'd get in this room, but that would be good. Dr. Anybody in Duluth should be presenting on Wednesday. In Duluth.
Oh, please help yourself to any snacks over here.
Snacks.
They look yummy.
Thanks.
How are you?
So is that picture? I was just trying, huh?
Yeah, this is Parker Schultz.
Oh, yeah. Before break.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I heard the fact that.
No, I don't know.
Yeah.